Hello, I welcome you to St. John's United Church for our online worship. This is Sunday, October 23rd, 2022. I do hope, as always, that this will help you in your faith and in your life. May you grow and become strong in the Lord. Peace be with you. Let the hearts that seek the Lord rejoice. Turn to the Lord and His strength. Constantly seek His face. Almighty ever-living God, increase our faith, hope, and charity, and make us love what You command, so that we may merit what You promise. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, Your Son, who lives and reigns with You in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Psalm chapter 7, verses 1 to 11 and verse 17. O Lord my God, in You I take refuge. Save me from all my pursuers, and deliver me, or like a lion they will tear me apart. They will drag me away, with no one to rescue. O Lord my God, if I have done this, if there is wrong in my hands, if I have repaid my ally with harm, or plundered my foe without cause, then let the enemy pursue and overtake me, trample my life to the ground, and lay my soul in the dust. Rise up, O Lord, in Your anger. Lift Yourself up against the fury of my enemies. Awake, O my God, You have appointed a judgment. Let the assembly of the peoples be gathered around You, and over it take Your seat on high. The Lord judges the peoples. Judge me, O Lord, according to my righteousness and according to the integrity that is in me. O let the evil of the wicked come to an end, but establish the righteous, You who test the minds and hearts, O righteous God. God is my shield, who saves the upright in heart. God is a righteous judge, and a God who has indignation every day. I will give to the Lord the thanks due to His righteousness, and sing praise to the name of the Lord, the Most High. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. What shall I render to the Lord for all this bounty to me? I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. O God, who teaches us by this act of worship that it is more blessed to give than to receive, graciously accept these our offerings and give us the right spirit both in giving and receiving. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Micah chapter 4, verses 1 to 5. In days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised up above the hills. Peoples shall stream to it, and many nations shall come and say, Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth instruction, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between many peoples, and shall arbitrate between strong nations far away. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. But they shall all sit under their own vines, and under their own fig trees, and no one shall make them afraid. For the mouth of the Lord of hosts has spoken. For all the peoples walk, each in the name of its God, but we will walk in the name of the Lord our God forever and ever. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 8 to 16. For if Joshua had given them rest, God would not speak later about another day. So then, a Sabbath rest still remains for the people of God. For those who enter God's rest also cease from their labors as God did from his. Let us therefore make every effort to enter that rest, so that no one may fall through such disobedience as theirs. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 to 46. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand, and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. Then he will say to those at his left hand, You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they also will answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you? Then he will answer them, Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we'd first begun.
Dear friends, Jesus teaches us to pray with humility and sincerity. In that spirit, let us place all our needs in God's merciful hands. We pray for the whole church, that, like Paul the Apostle, all the baptized will bear missionary witness to Christ with courage and conviction. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the pilgrim people of God, that believers everywhere will practice daily prayer that is humble and honest. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for those who face homelessness, that they will find the help they need to be safely housed. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the survivors of physical, sexual, or psychological abuse. May their voices be heard and their claims for justice be met. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the congregations of Campbellford and especially for Christ Church Anglican. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the family and friends of those who are recently deceased or whose anniversary of death occurs around this time, that they will be enfolded in the loving arms of God. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. God of mercy and compassion, your Son taught us to trust in your goodness. May the witness of our faith encourage many to believe in you. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. This is a test of the emergency broadcast system. If this had been an actual emergency, you would have been instructed to tune to one of the broadcast stations in your area. Do any of you recall this test or a variation of it? I remember it from when I was quite young, and it would have been on most Saturday mornings before the cartoons came on. It was always, you know, that test pattern they have? Maybe I'll get a shot of it up here. I remember getting up and just watching this test pattern. I was willing it to go away so the cartoons would start. It wasn't like today where we have, you know, broadcasts 24/7. And I think that's why I like Jack Kornfield's quote, "This life is a test. It is only a test. If it had been an actual life, you would have received further instructions on where to go and what to do. Remember, this life is only a test." I know that this is meant in humor, and I do find it humorous, but I see a great deal of truth in this statement. Because as Christians, we believe we have received further instructions on what to do and where we're going. We believe that Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and the righteous judge of humanity. We believe that we will stand before the seat of Christ, and our works, our lives, what we do, what we fail to do, what we think, what we fail to think, will be judged. Now, fortunately, we believe that there is forgiveness and mercy in God through Christ. Otherwise, the reality of that judgment would be, I think, too much for anyone to bear. But the other side is that sometimes we perceive this mercy or forgiveness as a divine right that means that nothing matters, that our works in life are irrelevant. And that isn't true. Our lives have impact, and they will be judged accordingly. The Apostle Paul, in his first epistle to the church in Corinth, compares people to builders. A building, right? Our lives are like a building. That's the analogy he's using. As Christians, we all have the same solid foundation. The foundation of our lives, if we are Christians, is Jesus Christ. This is what every Christian builds on. But Paul says that each of us can choose how we build on that foundation, or more precisely, what materials we use to build on that foundation. The foundation itself is solid, will never be lost, but the materials we build on top of the foundation may not last through the test. Some choose gold or silver as their materials to build with, things that will pass through the test of fire and will actually become more pure. Others choose hay or straw to build their lives on in Christ. These will be burned up. I really think the three little pigs is a great analogy of life and similar to God's, but to Paul's comparison. Some materials won't survive the test of life. But fortunately, we don't lose our lives completely because Christ is our foundation, and that won't disappear. Paul says it this way. If the work is burned up, the builder will suffer loss. The builder will be saved, but only as through fire. I have come to the conclusion that everything, or nearly everything, is a test. How we live our lives right now in this moment is a test of our faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the one who will come to judge the living and the dead. My favorite professor, who I reference every so often, used to say in response to those who complained about how bad the world was getting, "Well, that's what we're waiting for." Now, I know that sounds odd. Don't we want what is best for our world and for humanity? Yes, of course we do. But if the proclamation of the gospel is correct, it won't happen until Jesus finally returns to set everything right. According to my professor, which he based on the Bible, things will get a lot worse before they get better. Jesus must return in judgment so that all things can be made new. And that is why we say we believe in Jesus, who will return to judge the living and the dead. Many will be dead, but some will still be alive when he returns. And it's sort of like his birth. Some, like the shepherds, will recognize that the King of the universe has arrived. Others will see simply the birth of a peasant in a small, remote town. That we will see Jesus, that we will see God, is something that goes back in our history, both in the New Testament and Old Testament. Job, in his pain and suffering, still had the hope of seeing God, of seeing the Christ, the Redeemer. He says, "For I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been thus destroyed, then in my flesh I shall see God." That's Job 19, verses 25 and 26. To use a movie, Gladiator, General Maximus says to his soldiers, "Brothers, what we do in life echoes in eternity." As Christians, we don't simply believe what we do in life echoes in eternity. It will be judged in eternity. It will be judged by the one who is righteous. Every action you have taken, every thought you have had, will be revealed. I know it's a scary thought, isn't it? Yet the Apostle Paul states that these secret thoughts will be revealed. In Romans chapter 2, there he's speaking about the Gentiles. He says, "Their conflicting thoughts will accuse, or perhaps excuse them, on the day when, according to my gospel, God, through Jesus Christ, will judge the secret thoughts of all." Not just our actions, our thoughts. Some of us are pretty good in our outward actions. Some of us, for the most part, do what is right. But what if our thoughts were always revealed in life? What if there was a machine that could reveal every thought you have and others could see them? I just have to look at myself. I think I believe these teachings of the gospel. I affirm them constantly. I preach them nearly every week. But when I seriously examine my own actions, my own thoughts, I have to wonder sometimes how strongly I really believe and trust God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul speaks of examining ourselves before we partake of the body and blood of our Lord, the Lord's Supper he is talking about. He says this, "If we judged ourselves, we would not be judged." If we judged ourselves, we would not be judged. "Know thyself" was a phrase written over the temple of Apollo at Delphi in Greece. Though as Christians we affirm the true God of creation, there are things we can learn from other religions. There are truths that we can agree on. This is one of them. Know thyself. Judge yourself first before judging anyone else. Take the 2x4 out of your own eye before trying to take out the splinter in your brother's. The truth of Jesus' statement is also intended, I think, to be humorous. Because just think about that picture we're seeing. We have a 2x4 sticking out of our eye, and yet we have the gall to judge those around us. Get rid of that 2x4 first. Then maybe, just maybe, you can help that person who has a mere splinter in their eye. Are you prepared for the judgment that is to come? Do you believe that a real judgment is coming? Don't say this to make you afraid, rather to have courage to live good lives. Because the good news is that even if you have failed utterly in this life, if you have failed to build with materials that will survive the test, you still have Christ. You still have the foundation. The foundation will not be destroyed. But why not build with good materials? Why not examine your life and your thoughts and change? Change today. Why not build with at least a few materials that will survive the test? Why not live with the hope of the one who is to come, the one who will judge the living and the dead? This judge is full of love for you. And if this judge disciplines, it is only because he loves you so much. C.S. Lewis wrote and put it this way, "We are bidden to put on Christ, to become like God. That is, whether we like it or not, God intends to give us what we need, not what we now think we want. Some have said it this way: God's love is not content to leave you where you are. Everything is a test, if we'd only see it. Everything gives us the opportunity to live by faith in the one who will judge the living and the dead. I believe in Jesus, who ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. Peace be with you.
There's a jersey on the wall in the high school gym in my hometown. In the corner by the scoreboard, where the bleacher seats fold down. 27 took the Tigers to the finals that year. But that's not why it's hanging there. If I ever get to heaven, I got a long list of questions. Like, how do you make a snowflake? Are you angry when the earth quakes? How does the sky change in a minute? How do you keep this big rock spinning? Why couldn't you stop that car from crashing? Forgive me, I'm just asking. I bet somewhere there's a yearbook in a box under a bed with a senior picture missing, loving memories instead. I bet somewhere there's a mother who stopped going to church 'cause your plan quit making sense down here on earth. If I ever get, I got a long list of questions, like, how do you make a snowflake? Are you angry when the earth quakes? How does the sky change in a minute? How do you keep this big rock spinning? Why couldn't you stop that car from crashing? Forgive me, I'm just
You are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.